Good morning, everyone. We welcome you this morning to the service here at Pleasant Chapel Church. We do have a few announcements to go over, and if the ladies pay close attention for a few minutes here, we've just been invited up to Tom and Tammy Licky's cottage next Saturday, and to be there at 11 o'clock and bring a dish. So any of the ladies that would like to come, if they would see either Ellen or me after church, we'll try to coordinate driving up there to make a visit. And it's supposed to be a very pretty summer day, so hopefully a lot of you girls can go. Also, I believe the pastor would like a few minutes to speak to you this morning.
A few more minutes, huh? I always take so many. If you look at your bulletin, there's several things coming up. I wanted you to hit next Sunday, kind of a special Sunday, very special Sunday. We are recognizing our youth. We have Bibles to present to all of our kids, and I believe we're going to kind of have promotion and regrouping of our Sunday school or our children's worship classes. So that's going to take a big part of next week. It's going to be a great celebration of our kids. And stick around. We're going to have Sloppy Joes and fixings after, and hot dogs. Sloppy Joes and hot dogs, or chili dogs, or whatever you want to make out of that. So that's next week. Then on the 24th, I've been talking about this a little bit. We've got several people that have been attending regularly, and we just want to provide an opportunity for anyone who would be interested in becoming a member of the church. We're going to do that on the 24th of September. That day also we'll have available baptism. If you'd like to be baptized or have your children baptized, we'll do that then. We have a membership. It's a very short class that we'll meet on the 10th and the 17th to kind of go over what it means to be a member here. So just want to keep letting you know about this, provide the opportunity. If this is something you'd like to do, since we disaffiliated, we've got gobs of people that joined then, and now since then we've got 50 so or more that have been coming and are not members. If you'd like to be a part of this as a step of your faith and commitment to this local church, just would love to have you be a part of that. The 7th of October is the Soup Supper. The 8th, that's a Saturday. The 8th is our congregational conference. That's our annual meeting where all voting members can come together and we'll go over a few things and have some voting that day. October 22nd is Rally Day. Note that one because it was only published one other time in the directory, and that's a different date, but it's going to be the 22nd this year, so that's a little different. If you have a directory, you will have seen it was the week before, so note the change there. Tenderloins, more time than opportunities to eat fried, greasy, dead pigs on the 4th, so mark that down. That's a fun evening for everybody. So, yeah, got some stuff coming up. Participate. Thanks. That's all I got.
I don't think he forgot a thing, but is there anything else we need to bring up this morning? If not, let's quiet our hearts as we prepare to worship the Lord this morning.
Our reading today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 through 20. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we are humbled by the truth in that passage. We recognize that our bodies are temples of your Holy Spirit. Our bodies are gifts bought with the precious price of your Son's great sacrifice. Guide us to cherish and respect these vessels, nurturing them in ways that bring glory to you. May our actions, thoughts, and words reflect your presence within us. Strengthen us to honor you daily, for we belong to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And how you doing? Say next Sunday, I hope you all can be here, because next Sunday is going to be your Sunday. Every Sunday we love having you here, but this is going to be a very special day for you, so I hope you can all come. And I want to tell you what I've been doing this week. I've been making applesauce, lots and lots of applesauce. It's that time of year. And you know, sometimes apples fall off the tree, and when they do, what happens? They get a bruise, that's the exact word. And you know, that's a bad spot, and it's not going to get better. And if you don't take care of that bruise spot and cut it out before you make applesauce, your applesauce will all be bad. And if you don't cut it out and leave the apple go, look what happens. Ugh, it's no good. It just ruins it. So people are kind of like that too. Sometimes we get our feelings hurt or something bad happens and we just let it grow. We don't take care of it. We don't ask God for help, or we don't find a good way to make that bruise go away. And being in church and loving God, we find ways to cut that bruise out and save ourselves being miserable and looking like this apple, and having a better life too by loving God and trusting Him and knowing that things can get better, and they will with God's help. And we have to be accepting of what God wants for us too when He tells us to forgive and to make anew. So next time you get your feelings hurt or something doesn't go your way, think about this apple and if it's going to ruin you by not saying, that's okay, I forgive you, or I'm sorry, or let's try again. Okay, let's have a prayer, and I've got a treat for you as you go downstairs. Dear God, we thank you today for apples and applesauce and apple pie and apple fritters and all that. But mostly we thank you for helping us find ways to forgive, because you forgive us for the things we do, and we need to forgive others too. Please be with us this week. Keep us in your loving hands. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Alabama, old group of the 70s and 80s. Not all their songs were probably Christ-centered in nature, as that one is, and about the things of the Lord, but they took time out there and sang that song we all know, and I like that rendition of it. That's a fun one to sing. And you know, we've kind of been doing that this is the last Sunday of 11 Sundays that we've done sort of that, where we take music that is more popular on the radio than it would be in church, and we're taking some of the lyrics that are out of these popular songs and using those words that were written probably, no doubt, for another purpose. They're particularly love songs, and those songs were written with human love in mind, the ballads and different songs that we had about love, but we're taking those out and we're reusing them and we're repurposing them to talk about finding God's love, maybe afresh, in some of those familiar stories of the Old Testament. And so 11 weeks we've been doing this. If you've missed any, or if you've missed them all, we're going to summarize them there here in just a moment so you can catch up. You know, if you've been gone for 11 weeks, here in about a minute and 45 seconds, you will have got all the sermons. You'll be all caught up, because we're going to do them all in a row here. So here are the songs we talked about.
What's love got to do? Got to do with it.
Because I love a rainy night. Yeah, I love a rainy night.
It's me you need to show. How deep is your love?
Is your love?
How deep is your love?
Oh, baby, there ain't no mountain high enough. Ain't no valley low enough.
Stop in the name of love before you break my heart.
That's a strange way to tell me you love me.
Possible dream.
Once more, you open the door, and you're here in my heart, and my heart will go on and on.
That God bless the broken road that led me straight.
Covered a lot of genres, didn't we? Spanned a lot of years, a lot of different probably music styles that some of you probably know very well, and some of you probably never heard of before. I think it'd be kind of neat if somebody would jump in and watch this week's video and see that and wonder what the deuce were they doing in church that day that those songs were, you know, for 11 weeks we talked about those songs. But you know, we used those songs and some specific words out of those songs for us to think more deeply about God's love for his people as he demonstrated it in so many ways throughout the Old Testament. And I've said this over again several times, that when we in our faith think about the God of the Old Testament, sometimes that's a little more difficult for us to think about God as a loving God back then. And sometimes we incorrectly think that he was a different God then. No, he's the same God forever and always, and he is a God of love. We saw that love in the very creation of all, in all things, in the restarting of humanity when humanity had just messed up and God restarted humanity in the flood and at the Tower of Babel. The depth of his love, how deep is your love, was evidenced in his faithfulness and his requirement of faithfulness in his people, as was shown in the story of Abraham and Isaac. His love was also shown when he provided the law. All that law that Moses was given to the people, and that law was a means to provide boundaries for people, limitations for people who are just by themselves prone to wander away from him and just then therefore kept in distant relationship or no relationship with him. Purpose of the law. And that love sometimes we would probably call today hard love. It was hard love like that which happened at the flood. And that hard love often was a strange way for God to show us his love as he demonstrated so often his intolerance for evil and his hatred towards immorality as he ordered the annihilation of whole groups of people that were so far away from him and literally hell-bent on a life that was rebellious to him. David was a man that we singled out. He was called after God's own heart, despite all of David's shortcomings. We know David had so many faults and so many so many sins, but yet David was a good king, and he represented the many leaders that God put in place, and those leaders were good leaders because God was their true king of their heart. Then we had Gomer Pyle singing To Dream the Impossible Dream, and that one, you know, that was a little weird one there, because there it was so much more about Gomer and Gomer's name, because we use that to draw the similarity between biblical Gomer, who's found in the book of Hosea, the similarity between her and humanity. Because Gomer represents what the people of God so often represented, and what we so often act out is our unfaithfulness. Gomer was unfaithful to her husband at that time. She sought out after other things, yet because of God's steadfast and enduring love, his people could continue to dream that impossible dream and hope for something that would happen, that would be this completely restored relationship that only he could do. We singled out a couple of prophets, Jeremiah and Daniel, who would bring hope and assurance to the people who so needed it, because they were so down and so messed up because of their transgressions, that they had been exiled and they had been lost in regards to their way of worship, and had lost Jerusalem, had lost their temple. But yet God's love would go on, as the theme from Titanic would tell us there. God would continue to go on and love us and pursue us. And there is a future that he holds for his people in his hand. And what tremendous hope that would be for the people then, and what awesome hope it is for us as well. And then that road that we are on, and the people throughout all time have been on, it's often difficult, and it's often broken because of what we have done, but yet people that are in God find that broken road blessed, because that road in him would bring his people back to him. So those 10 weeks that we went through, and I had fun going through and picking out songs. I like music. I like a lot of different genres of music and listening to those. And it's kind of a neat frame of mind where you could, you know, you start listening to songs on the radio and songs that aren't necessarily Christian kinds of songs. You say, boy, there's some truths in there. There's some truths. Wouldn't it be really cool if Elton John would have been singing for the Lord? Or wouldn't it have been really cool if Boston would have, you know, had those guitar riffs about bringing greatness to God there? Because those words oftentimes do reflect this awesome character attribute of God, that he is a God of love. And so as we looked at that, we found these stories and the context of the stories, and yeah, we do see his love in there, but it's not, and I caution us here, it's not just about us looking back on these past actions of God. They're real stories, and we find God's action. We find his presence in those stories. But the reading of those stories is also for us. The reading of those stories really is, it is us, because we're in those stories. Those stories are about us too, you and me. All these years later, we are part of this story because we have been called into that story. And part of our journey here is to find our place in that story, where it is we fit into that story, and then respond accordingly. We too have been part of God's love in that creative process, that very first week that we had. What's love got to do with it? Love's got everything to do with creation, and that's not just then, it's now. We too are part of that creative process. You're not random. You're not just some happenstance thing of chaos that all of a sudden you exist. You're not the choosing of your parents, and you didn't choose to be here, and yet you are. He chose. You didn't choose. He did. He made you out of his love, part of his creative work. He made you, and he created you for his purposes. And I think about that, and I could stop right there, because that is just such a tremendous change in mindset. We didn't choose this. You didn't choose your being here. He did. And boy, I could stop right there and talk of all the problems that we have going on in our world, the issues that we have individually, the struggles that we have. If we would more adopt that mindset that he's chosen me, he has created me for purpose and for his will, a lot of this stuff goes away. A lot of our problems go away, but we'll leave it at that, and I just challenge you to think deeply about that. You're not random. He picked you. And those stories about his intolerance for immorality and evil, that's for us. He simply will not stand for the evil then, as he did then. He's not going to stand for it now. He has provided for us the same kinds of things that he's done for the people then, these guidelines and regulations and boundaries for our behavior. And there's an expectation for us to live if we are claiming to be his followers. It's his will, and it's his way. It's not about how it is that we feel. That comes way down the road. He required great faith then, and he requires great faith for us today. He's ultimately faithful to do what it is he said he would do, and he's done that. And he requires us to be people who function out of faith, just as he is a faithful God. That's life change for us. To live as people of faith is not natural. That takes work, and that takes the power of the Spirit within us to be people of faith. And for us too, just as for those people then, there ain't no mountain high enough that's going to keep his love away from us. Not death, not life, no angels, rulers, things present, things to come, nor powers, height, depth, anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ. Paul talks to us in Romans chapter 8, there and then, for us, here and now. And we too, like the people then who would have been lost and on their broken roads and having these difficult times, have tremendous hope. God is going to carry people through them then, and he will for us as well. He holds our future too. He's got a plan that he's going to fulfill in each of us. Even though our roads seem busted and full of potholes, he's blessing them. He's blessing this road because he's bringing us back to him. He loves. He is love. And he loves you and me so deeply. That's the truth that I'm finding out of this love of God in the Old Testament. The question, second question for you today is, what are you doing about it? Because it's for you. You are in this story and he loves you tremendously. What are you doing about it? The last song that I snuck in there was today's song. We haven't talked about that one. Open Arms is a song by Journey, 80s song. Stephen Perry was the singer of that. Clearly, it was a love song back in kind of my younger days. And yeah, it's about human man love, a human man and woman love. But that lyric that is the chorus there, he says, "I come to you with open arms," expressing his love. And that line there, I think, does depict possibly the greatest demonstration of God's love for his people. And it is so central to this story that God will come, and he will come with open arms. This overarching theme that is throughout the Bible, that God says, "I will come and I will dwell among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." If I can take you to the end, we win. We know this for sure if we go clear back to the end of the Bible and look at the last book of the Bible in Revelation chapter 21, we hear of the fulfillment of this promise of God that he is coming to dwell with his people. He says this in verse 3. This would be John talking about a vision that he had here about things to come. "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals.'" There it is. God's home is among the people. "He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them." Throughout all of Scripture, this is the promise that he made. He will dwell among the people. This is what was originally intended. This is what the purpose of God had done in that garden when he created humanity, that we all would be physically and literally with him. But we know that was broken. It was broken because humanity gave into the temptation that took place in the garden, and the effects and the consequences of that sin has penetrated all of life ever since. But even then, at the very moments after Adam and Eve had sinned and the consequences of sin came, God puts into place already this plan of restoration, already because of his love. In spite of this, right when this happened, let's take a look at this. Go flip back to the front of your Bible, to the first book. Chapter 3 is the fall of man, when the serpent came and tempted them. And now God is in the middle of handing out the curses. And you know, he tells the woman, you're going to have pain in childbirth. And he tells the man, you're going to struggle because the ground's going to be cursed. And then he comes to the serpent and he says this in verse 14 of chapter 3. To the serpent he says, because you've done this, cursed are you among the animals and among wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all of the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head, and you shall strike his heel. Many interpreters or biblical scholars says that is the first instance of the good news in the Bible, that there is this good news that would come. Because all of the world up to this point is going to be damned forever because of sin. But yet we find out here that God is starting this process of fixing things that got broken in Eden. The serpent and evil will be done away with. Dust you shall eat. That is language that's used in biblical language to talk about utter humility. You will be done away with, and you will be annihilated and humiliated and done away with forever. We say, eat my dust, don't we? We say that, that talks about, you know, you're going to whoop your competitor in a race, right? Eat my dust. Well, it's similar to this. It's this, but much more consequential. God is saying this to the serpent, that you will eat dust and be forever done. There is going to be an end to the problem of sin. Much of what we have recorded in the Old Testament witnesses to this happening. And how it will happen will be the coming of this one. Throughout Scripture, there is so many passages that talk about one who will come to bring fulfillment to this promise. Now, at the time that these would have been written, as we look at these in the Old Testament, for the people of the original hearers and the original readers of this, they wouldn't have got it. They wouldn't have understood it then. But because of where you and I are at, we're on the other side of all of this story, and we can understand it because we have the advantage of looking back. And so let's look at some of these passages that talk about this amazing process. And again, is this tremendous revelation of God's love that he's going to put an end to this by sending one who would come to put an end to all the problem that humanity has. David would be a king, we talked about. So we jump into the story here. And in the book of 2 Samuel, in the 7th chapter, Samuel says this about David's kingship. When your days, David, are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name forever. And here it is. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. And we know, again, this to be true as you look at the two gospel accounts, Matthew and Luke, I believe, that talk about the genealogies of Christ the King. Christ comes from the lineage of David, which is the fulfillment of this prophecy, that from you, David, is going to be the one that is going to come. And then all the prophetic books that we have, we talked about a couple of them the last few weeks, but so many of those prophets came and they spoke about this one that would come. And this one would come and he would dwell among us. Now think about this. Think about these passages that we'll read here. Think about if we go back to the time they would have been written, you know, how well would have we understood them? Micah says this. He's talking about Bethlehem. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, you are one of the little clans of Judah. From you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origins is from old, from ancient days. Bethlehem was kind of a nothing during the ancient Near East times. But yet this passage is saying this, out of you, Bethlehem's going to come something. Think about that. The people of the time would think about, you know, a small burg like Collamer or, you know, a town like that. What good can come out of a small burg like Roanoke or something like that? How can this possibly be? That probably is the same sort of significance that Bethlehem would have had. We get it, don't we? We know what came from Bethlehem. We talk about it every Christmas, don't we? We understand what that prophecy was about. Isaiah has several passages similar here. Chapter 7 of Isaiah, verse 14, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman," or some translations say a virgin, "is with child and shall bear a son and shall be named Emmanuel." Probably just hopeful, cryptic kinds of words for the people at the time. But again, we know that, don't we? We understand it because we can look back and we know exactly who that prophet was talking about. He later would say this about that one, "For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom." Tremendous hope for the people of Isaiah's time who had lost their nation and lost their country and lost their nationality and lost their brotherhood and lost their ways of worship and lost Jerusalem. Somebody's coming. One is coming. What a tremendous promise for the people. Pretty symbolic for those people then. But for anybody after the first Christmas and the first Easter, they would have known. They would have gotten it. They would have known that Emmanuel, which means God is with us, they would have known it. God is really here. He was here physically, and he was in flesh, and he did dwell among us, and he's now here with us as he's promised, coming in the Spirit in the form of the Comforter. And then, too, the prophets talked about that one that came, what his ministry would be like. And again, for the people at the time, I think this would have been tough. Isaiah says this, that when this child grew up, chapter 53 and verse 2, "Before him like a young plant and like a root out of the dry ground, he had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne on our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that has made us whole, and by his bruises we're healed." They wouldn't have gotten it then, but we get it today, don't we? We know exactly who we're talking about there, don't we? We know whose bruises, we know whose stripes, we know who carried the transgressions of all of us. Zechariah says this, "Rejoice, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king's come to you. Your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding into town on a Hummer, riding into town on an Abrams tank, riding into town in a A-10 Warthog. No, your king comes riding in Jerusalem when his time came on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Would have probably caused the people of Zechariah's time to kind of wonder what that meant. We know exactly what that's talking about. We know Holy Week, when Jesus came and fulfilled that perfectly. Later on in the same book, Zechariah says, "And I will pour out my spirit of compassion and supplication on the house of David," there it is again, "and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that when they look on the one whom they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and weep bitterly over him as one weeps over a firstborn." This one would come and be pierced. And we know that the soldiers pierced Jesus' side to ensure that he had died on the cross. Many passages in the Old Testament, that remember, it's our one Bible, but these passages were written way before the time of Christ. Some scholars say there are hundreds of these throughout Scripture, some of them more clear than others, but what is most true here is that God has done what he said he would do. God did just this. He came to dwell among his people, and that's just a tremendous thing. He would descend from the highest glory, and he clothed himself with skin, with blood and bone to become one of us for the purpose that we could eternally dwell with him. We get this. You and I get it because we're on the other side of that BC and AD timeline. We understand that. And I believe one of the greatest things of all times is when God says, paraphrased, I will come with open arms, nothing to hide. Believe what I say. Yeah, those are journey songs, but I think that paraphrases what God did in Christ, that he would come. He would come with these open arms, and he hopes you'll see what his love really means by those open arms. He said he would come, and he did. And when he left, he said, I gotta go. Because if I don't go, then I can't send the one who will be with you forever. They wouldn't have gotten it at the time, but he was saying this dwelling is going to take place when the Comforter comes. Three passages that talk about this real quickly. John says this in chapter 14. This is Jesus speaking about the coming one. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Tremendous promise. Paul then later on can process this a little bit after this has happened, after Pentecost, when the Spirit came, and he tells this to the people, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? What a fantastic thing this would have been for the people. These would have been people that understood the only way that they connected with God was in Jerusalem, in that temple, with the stuff, with the animals, with the blood, with the smell, all that had taken place. And now, boy, what a change. Paul says, no, you are the temple because he resides in you. The Spirit dwells within you. And again, he reiterates the same thing later on in the same book. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God with your body, in your body. This, for our faith, I believe it's such a fantastic, this fantastic truth that's about Christianity, that God resides within the believer. No other faith system has it that way, that God would come with his open arms, that he would take up residence with his people. But yet God has done that with us. We can barely begin to wrap ourselves around that truth, that he has come and he's taken up residency with us. See, your life and my life, first and foremost, is spiritual. You are spiritual. You're having a physical human experience. You're spiritual first, you're human second. Your physicalness, that's going to perish. It's only temporary. Your spiritual self, the real you, that's your real self. And it's that which will go on into all of eternity, either heaven or hell. And the all-powerful, all-creating, all-knowing one is present in your life for those who have entrusted life to him. That's a real presence in our life. It's fantastic. That one who is the one of all of these stories that we have been talking about, he promised he would come, and because he's so faithful, he did. He came. We know that. We know it. We get it. Christmas, water to wine, deaf to hear, dead to life, arrested, a cross, a death, a burial, and then Easter and an ascension. We know that. We know the story. He came, and we have the story. We know it. We know the facts. But we are the story too. He's faithful in that coming. That one that is faithful came then, and he comes here and now to you and to me. And these are tough words, but we are different than those who have yet trusted in him, because he simply is not present with them. He's promised to come to dwell among those who would receive him and not in them. There's a tremendous difference then between those who have received Christ and those who haven't. Try to grasp that. Think about that. Of all the people you're going to encounter today, you, if you have entrusted Christ in your life, the very one himself who has created all and knows all and is all is within you. And he's not in people who have refused and rejected and have not trusted in him. It's unbelievable. And I don't mean unbelievable in that sense. It's just unfathomable. That's a better word. Yeah, it is believable. We have to believe it. But what does that mean for us? And I'll be honest with you. I can tell you this. I can expose Scripture. I think that's my job, is to come and show you this truth. This is what this says, and this is what it means for you and I. And I can tell you about these promises, but I will tell you, I struggle with what that really means. I'm dumbfounded by the implications of that truth in my life, that his very presence is here. That's difficult for me. And I think that is by design. I think there is and always will be an element of mystery to that I never will fully understand or comprehend or be able to fully appreciate. I'm never going to get that. But from a practical sense, knowing this, what does it mean? What does it mean for me? What am I doing as a result of knowing that that is true? What are the fruits of his presence in my life? What evidence in my life is there of this new life that he's promised that has happened because of his presence in me? How is my life dictated by his will because of what he's done and this promise that he's given to me, that he's taken up residency in me? It's tough. It's tough to grasp. I don't know your heart, and I don't think it's my job to do so. But what I do know is that God is so faithfulness, and this truth is for you as well. He has these open arms, and he's inviting you to be in him and he in you. And the effects of that truth for you, it's beyond anything you can imagine. And for me here and now, I believe it's past time that you and I and the rest of his church throughout this world more fully realize the greatness that he is within us, and that it's time for we to respond accordingly. Would you stand and we will pray. Father, we just can't begin to thank you enough for this faithful promise that we have, that we who are in you possess you, that you dwell within us, and then therefore you possess us. We confess we've probably forgotten that, taken it for granted, used it in contempt, but hear our hearts now as we have approached your word once again that reveals this truth to us, that you're in us. May we go from here being people more in tune with you and us, and allow the world to see you once again through us. In Jesus, amen.